Well, bee-bop-a-doodle, she's my baby. Bee-bop-a-doodle, I don't mean maybe. Bee-bop-a-doodle, she's my baby. Bee-bop-a-doodle, I don't mean maybe. Bee-bop-a-doodle, she is my baby, down my baby, down my baby, down. She's a woman in red blue jeans. She's a woman that's a queen of the teens. She's the one, a woman that I know. She's a woman that loves me so. Bee-bop-a-doodle, she's my baby. Bee-bop-a-doodle, I don't mean maybe. Bee-bop-a-doodle, she is my baby doll, my baby doll, my baby doll. Got that beat, and she's a woman with the flying feet. She's the one, a woman that I know. She's a woman that loves me so. Bee-bop-a-doodle, she's my baby. Bee-bop-a-doodle, I don't mean maybe. Bee-bop-a-doodle, she is my baby doll, my baby doll, my baby doll.
Just a lonely boy, lonely and blue. Got in town a month ago. I seen a lot of girls since then. If I could meet them, I could get them. But as yet I haven't met them. That's why I'm in the shape I'm in. Here another Saturday night, and I ain't got nobody. I got some money, cause I just got paid. Now how I wish I had someone to talk to. I'm in an awful way. Now, another fella told me he had a sister who looked just fine. Instead of being my deliverance, she had a strange resemblance to a cat named Frankenstein. Here another Saturday night, and I ain't got nobody. I got some money, cause I just got paid. Now how I wish I had some shit to talk to. I'm in an awful way, yeah. It is another weekend, I ain't got nobody. Man, if I was back home, I'd be swinging two chicks on my arm. Oh, yeah. Listen to me, huh? It's hard on a fella when he don't know his way around. If I don't find me a honey to help me spend my money, I'm gonna have to blow this town. Here it's another Saturday night, and I ain't got nobody. I got some money, cause I just got paid. Now how I wish I had some chick to talk to. I'm in an awful. Everybody sang another Saturday night, and I ain't got nobody. I got some money, cause I just got paid. Now how I wish I had someone to talk to. I'm in an awful. One more time, another Saturday night, and I ain't got nobody. I got some money, cause I just got paid. Now how I wish I had some chick to talk to.
Can be found sitting home all alone. If you can't come around, at least please telephone. Don't be cruel to who heart is true. Baby, if I made you mad for something I might have said, please don't forget my past. The future looks bright ahead. Don't be cruel to who heart is true. I don't want no other love, baby, it's just you I'm thinking of. Don't stop thinking of me. Don't make me feel this way. Come on over here and love me. You know what I want you to say. Don't be cruel to who heart is true. Why should we be apart? I really love you, baby, cross my heart. Let's walk up to the preacher and let's say I do. Then you'll know you'll have me, and I know that I'll have you. Don't be cruel to who heart is true. I don't want no other love, oh baby.
The number four upset of all time, the Browns 1950 opening day game.
Four. 1950, Browns versus Eagles.
Ironic as it may seem, Pro Football's World Series takes place the first week of the 1950 season as the Cleveland Browns, champions of the All-American Conference, take on the defending kingpins of the NFL, the Philadelphia Eagles.
No one gave the Browns a chance to win.
Cleveland joined the NFL after the All-American Football Conference dissolved in 1949. But at the time, the Browns were considered more of a rogue outfit than a legitimate organization.
The owners, the executives of the NFL, looked down on the All-American Conference. Both the players weren't as good, both the coaches weren't as good. They thought it was a minor league product. They laughed at Paul Brown. They called him a high school coach.
The NFL viewed the former AAFC team as nothing more than a carnival act with its run-and-gun offense and unusual off-the-field activities.
The players, during their free time, engage in some sports activity. Keeps them in shape, they say.
Bert Bell, who personally made up the league schedule, scheduled the first game was going to be the Philadelphia Eagles.
The Eagles were two-time defending champions and viewed as the real class act in pro football.
We're going to open the season against the Cleveland Browns in Philadelphia, and that was no accident. I mean, Bert Bell wanted to put these guys in their place right away.
Here's the kind of action that will thrill you fans.
Brown was telling the players what they already knew. This league has no respect for you. This game is a setup. They're expecting you to go in there and get crushed.
We were so ready. We were foaming at the mouth almost. We were ready to play that game.
They had dominated the All-American Football Conference. They had won all four league championships.
The autumn cavalcade of sport is both colorful and exciting.
What was supposed to be a battle of league champions turned into a one-sided slaughter and our number four upset.
The Browns just dominated. That by halftime, that game was pretty much over.
They were too smart for them. They were too quick for them.
They weren't prepared to deal with the Browns' passing attack. They had no idea how good players like Otto Graham and Marion Motley, how good these guys were.
After the game, Bert Bell came in and he said it was the best football team, the most intense football team he had ever seen.
And they drew 71,000 people. It was the biggest regular season attendance ever for the Philadelphia Eagles and remains so to this day.
The Browns went on to win the 1950 NFL championship, suggesting that our number four upset was no fluke.
And the Browns have added another championship, this one a cherished conquest in the National Football League.
And the Browns had proved they were talented enough and well coached enough that they would not just be able to compete, but be able to thrive in the NFL.
The Rams opened on the coast for the first time in 1946. But it wasn't until the 50s that they began to command center stage. Led by the quarterbacking duo of number 11, Norm Van Brocklin, and Bob Waterfield, number 7, the Rams won the NFL title in 1951. The Errol Flynn and Clark Gable of the gridiron, Van Brocklin and Waterfield were the leading men in a point-a-minute offense that could light up the scoreboard like a basketball team. A strong supporting cast also played a large part in the Rams' early success. Elroy Crazy Legs Hirsch, number 40, was the most dangerous pass receiver of his era. And he lived up to his nickname by gaining a club record 6,289 career yards. Hirsch became the first pass catcher to perfect the long bomb. Few receivers have ever been able to turn a short pass into a big gain like Tom Fears, number 55. Los Angeles's all-time leading receiver with 400 catches, Fears' elusive running style perfectly complemented the power approach of the Rams' big backs of the 50s. Number 32, Deacon Dan Towler, Dick Horner, and Tank Younger, number 35, were appropriately coined the Bull Elephant Backfield as they stampeded through NFL defenses.
You can dance every dance with the guy who gives you the eye, let him hold you tight. You can smile every smile for the man who held your hand neath the pale moonlight. But don't forget who's taking you home and in whose arms you're gonna be. So darling, say the last dance for me. Oh, I know,
oh, I know
that the music's
yes,
fine like sparkling
oh,
wine. Go and have your
yes,
fun.
Oh, I know.
Laugh and sing.
Yes, I know.
But while we're apart,
the Los Angeles Rams versus the winners in the American Conference of the National Football League, the Cleveland Browns.
Now we're ready for the World Championship game, a real thriller fetter. 60,000 sun-drenched fans are on hand here at the huge Los Angeles Coliseum as the Los Angeles Rams come charging onto the field to boast a log of 11 wins and one loss for the 1951 season. Los Angeles coach Joe Stoddard will have his hands plenty full this afternoon, and he'll be counting heavily on his talented quarterback Bob Waterfield, passing and field goal specialist. And Nolan Van Brocklin, second half of the powerful Ram aerial circus, here passing to rangy Tom Fears, one of the greatest ends in National League football. Paul Brown, coach of the Cleveland team, has a few tricks up his sleeve, too. Passing master, Otto Graham. Flashing fullback, Marion Motley. And sticky-fingered pass receivers, Max Speedy, number 58, Daddy Lavelli, and Dub Jones. Here's the toss of the coin with Waterfield representing the Rams, Tony Adamley representing Cleveland. That's referee Russell Gibbs. Captain Tony Adamley wins the toss of the coin, elects to receive. The Browns will be defending the East goal. Woodley Lewis kicks off for Los Angeles, a high floating kick that goes out of bounds in the Cleveland 22. Time for possibly one more play, 6 seconds remaining on the scoreboard clock. Graham calls the play, the fatal play, the last play of the game, the last play of the season. There's a lateral pass out to Ken Carpenter. Carpenter runs to his right and throws a forward pass down to Lavelli, but it's incomplete. And there's the gun, ending the ball game and making the Los Angeles Rams the world champions of 1951. Final score, the Los Angeles Rams 24, Brown 17. We have seen the making of a new Major League Football champion, the Los Angeles Rams, Cleveland Browns, American Conference leader.
Long distance information, give me Memphis, Tennessee. Help me find a party to try to get in touch with me. She could not leave a number, but I know who place to call. Cause my uncle took the message and he wrote it on the wall. Help me, information, get in touch with my Marie. She's the only one who'd call me if I'm Memphis, Tennessee. Her home is on the south side, high up on the ridge, just a half a mile from the Mississippi Bridge. Last time I saw Marie, she was waving me goodbye. With her home drops on her cheek that trickled from her eye. But we were pulled apart because her mom did not agree. And tore apart our happy home in Memphis, Tennessee. Help me, information, more than that I cannot add. Only that I miss her and all the fun we had. Marie is only 6 years old. Information, please. Try to put me through to her in Memphis, Tennessee.
Saturday night and I just got paid. Don't about my money, don't try to save. My heart says go, go, have a time. Cause it's Saturday night and baby, I feel fine. I'm gonna rock it up, I'm gonna rip it up, I'm gonna shake it up, I'm gonna break it up, I'm gonna lock it up at the ball tonight. Well, I got me a baby and I won't be late. Pick her up in my 88. I shag on down by the social hall. When the joint starts jumping, jumping, gonna have me a ball. I'm gonna rock it up, I'm gonna rip it up, I'm gonna shake it up, I'm gonna break it up, I'm gonna lock it up at the ball tonight. Went along about 10, I'm breezing high. I walk on out to that groovy sky. But I don't care if I spend my dough, cause tonight I'm gonna be one happy soul. I'm gonna rock it up, I'm gonna rip it up, I'm gonna shake it up, I'm gonna break it up, I'm gonna lock it up at the ball tonight. Go, 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 go. My heart says go, go, have a time on Saturday night. And baby, I feel fine, I'm gonna rock it up, I'm gonna rip it up, I'm gonna shake it up, I'm gonna break it up, I'm gonna lock it up at the ball tonight. Well, along about 10, I'm breezing high. I walk on out into the groovy sky. But I don't care if I spend my dough, cause tonight I'm gonna be one happy soul. I'm gonna rock it up, I'm gonna rip it up.
Oh yes, I'm the great pretender. One can tell. Oh yes, I'm the great pretender. Adrift in a world of my own, I play the game, but to my real shame, you've left me to dream all alone. Conceal. Oh, yes, I'm the great pretender. Just laughing and gay like a clown, I seem to be, but I'm not. You see, I'm wearing my heart like a crown. Still around. Too real is this feeling of make believe. Too real when I feel what my heart can't conceal. Yes, I'm the great pretender. Just laughing and gay like a clown.
He was selected in the ninth round of the 1955 NFL draft, but soon cast away by the Pittsburgh Steelers. After a year of playing semi-pro ball, the Baltimore Colts gave this quarterback from Western PA a chance on the pro gridiron. A long shot to make it, he got his opportunity in the fourth game of the 1956 season when an injury to the Colts' starting QB allowed him to step onto the field. And as they say, the rest is history. And history is something Johnny Unitas made a lot of during a memorable 18-season career. Johnny U, in his trademarked high-top shoes, led the Colts to great success and along the way spread his name throughout the NFL record book. He engineered the game-tying and game-winning drives in the 1958 championship game known as the greatest game ever played. His encore performance included leading Baltimore to its second straight world title the next year. But perhaps his signature on the game can be traced to an amazing streak in which he assaulted an NFL record. In 1929, one of the game's first true passers, Hall of Famer Benny Friedman, set an NFL record by throwing a TD pass in seven straight games. A bit more than a decade later, that mark was broken by another Hall of Fame passer, Arnie Herber of the Green Bay Packers, who strung together 9 games with a pass to the end zone. In the early 40s, Packers QB Cecil Isbell added his name to the record book with a 22-game streak over parts of 2 seasons. Late in his rookie season, Johnny Yu threw a touchdown pass in a game against the Los Angeles Rams. It would be another 3-plus seasons before he failed to throw a touchdown pass during a game as he embarked on a remarkable 47-game streak that stood unchallenged for more than 50 years. From a sandlot player to a Hall of Famer who became the NFL's first 40,000-yard passer, the journey of Johnny Yu was your classic rags-to-riches story and will forever be attached to his incredible streak.
I used to play around with hearts pacing at my call. When I met that little girl, knew that I would fall. Poor little fool, oh yeah, I was a fool. Play around and tease me with her carefree devil eyes. She'd hold me close and kiss me, but her heart was full of lies. Poor little fool, oh yeah, I was a fool.
Poor little fool, I was a fool, oh yeah.
She told me that she cared for me, that we'd never part. So for the very first time, I gave away my heart. Poor little fool, oh yeah, I was a fool.
Poor little fool, I was a fool, oh yeah.
Next day she was gone and I knew she lied to me. She left me with a broken heart, won her victory. Poor little fool, oh yeah, I was a fool.
Poor little fool, I was a fool, oh yeah.
Well, I played this game with other hearts, but I never thought I'd see the day when someone else would play love's foolish game with me. Poor little fool, oh yeah, I was a fool.
Poor little fool, I was a fool, oh yeah.
Poor little fool, oh yeah, I was a fool.
December 29th, 1957, and the eyes of the sports world turn to Detroit, Michigan for professional football's World Championship. A sellout crowd numbering more than 5,000 makes its way into Briggs Stadium,
for the Silver Anniversary Championship battle that pits the Cleveland Browns against the Detroit Lions. This will mark the fourth time the Lions and Browns have met in 1957. The teams broke even in a pair of preseason games, while the Lions won a 20-7 decision in league play. Nick Kerbaway on the left, Detroit's debonair general manager, welcomes the Cleveland Browns president, David Jones, to Detroit. The Western Conference champions, the Detroit Lions, receive a royal welcome from the partisan Motor City Rooters. The Lions posted a season log of 8-4, and then went on to defeat San Francisco in a spectacular playoff to win the conference crown for the fifth time. Cleveland is far from being a stranger to championship play, for this is the Browns' seventh title appearance in the last eight seasons. Under the direction of Coach Paul Binship, Browns' coaching record is one of football's finest. In number 15, Tommy O'Connell, Cleveland has the league's leading passer. During the season, O'Connell completed better than 57% of his passes. The Browns also own the league's leading ground gainer. He's Jim Brown, 225-pound fullback from Syracuse, who gained 942 yards while earning Rookie of the Year laurels. Coach of the Year honors go to Detroit's George Wilson. Wilson took over just prior to the start of the season and won the conference crown on his first try. A broken ankle will sideline Detroit's regular signal caller, Bobby Lane, but Bob will help out on the phone. Tobin Roach, an eight-year pro veteran, will direct the Detroit offense. This will be Roach's first appearance in a championship game. Howard Hopalong Cassidy, former All-American from Ohio State, is the Lions' chief breakaway threat. John Henry Johnson is Detroit's bread and butter back. Johnson was number four in rushing in the National Football League. The Lions' top rookie is Steve Junker. He's a 6'3", 220-pound end from Xavier and one of the four first-year men on the squad. Yale Larry handles the punting chores for the Lions and also mans a defensive halfback position. The Detroit secondary, one of the best in the business, also includes Jim David, Jack Christensen, Joe Schmidt, and Roger Zatkoff. Cleveland co-captains Mike McCormick, number 74, and number 70, Don Colo, win the coin toss from Tobin Roach and Joe Schmidt, and the Browns will receive. The lights are turned on in Briggs Stadium. Both teams are ready. The World Championship is about to begin. And stepping up to the Miller High Life microphone for the first half play-by-play is Earl Gillespie.
Thank you, Chris Schenkel, and that's Jim Martin kicking off for Detroit. It's a booming boot that carries clear out of the end zone for a touchback.
I thought I saw my future bride walking up the street. I shouted to the driver, "Hey, conductor, you must slow down. I think I see her. Please let me off the bus." Nadine, honey, is that you? Oh, Nadine, honey, is that you? Seems like every time I see you, darling, you got something else to do. coffee, please. Moving through the traffic like a mounted cavalier, leaning out the taxi window, trying to make a hair. Maybe, honey, is that you? Oh, Nadine, honey, is that you? Seem like every time I see you, darling, you up to something new.
Well, it's a darn good life, and it's kind of funny how the Lord made the bee, and the bee made the honey, and the honey bee looking for a home. And they called it a honeycomb, and they roamed the world, and they gathered all of the honeycomb into one sweet ball. And the honeycomb from a million trips made my baby's lips. So honeycomb, won't you be my baby? Well, a honeycomb, be my own. Got a hank of hair and a piece of bone. They made a walking, talking honeycomb. Well, a honeycomb, won't you be my baby? Well, a honeycomb, be my own. What a darn good life when you've got a wife like honeycomb.
Honeycomb.
And the Lord said, now that I made a bee, I'm gonna look all around for a green, green tree. Made a little tree, and I guess you heard it. Oh, then, well, he made a little bird, and they waited all around till the end of spring, getting every note that the birdies sing, and they put them all into one sweet tone. For my honeycomb, oh, honeycomb, won't you be my baby? Well, a honeycomb, be my own. Got a hank of hair and a piece of bone, they made a walking, talking honeycomb. Well, a honeycomb, won't you be my baby? Well, a honeycomb, be my own. What a darn good life when you've got a wife like honeycomb.
Honeycomb.
And the Lord said, now that I made a bird, I'm gonna look all around for a little old word. Sound about sweet like...